Welcome to the Off the Charts Football Podcast. I'm Matt Manocherian, former NFL scout and currently of Sports Info Solutions, joined as always by Aaron Schatz of Football Outsiders, producer Justin Stein, and researcher Patrick Rowley. Shout out to those guys. Aaron, we saw the Super Bowl. The game is past us. Your Patriots have won again. And most importantly, we're still here in the offseason keeping the podcast going.
Surprise! We are here to review the Super Bowl and talk free agency and the draft and everything else throughout the offseason. Football never ends. Football never stops.
We're going to keep it going. We know that we've built up a bit of a following base over the course of the year, and we love all of our listeners, and we want to keep this going throughout the offseason, keep giving it to you guys. So keep letting us know what you want to hear. Reach out to us on Twitter. And let us know what you want to hear on the podcast, because we'll have some flexibility in the off season. For today, though, let's talk Super Bowl. Aaron, what were your biggest overall takeaways in the game?
My biggest overall takeaway was the fantastic game planning by the Patriots staff on defense to take the defense that was average during the season and use it to completely shut down one of the top offenses in football, the LA Rams. And while that's going to get most of the discussion, we also should not forget the really great defensive performance by the Rams defense, which was also pretty average during the regular season, and almost shut off the Patriots offense to where the Patriots offense had negative DVOA on offense, just didn't perform as badly as the Rams offense did.
So I'm going to say something really controversial here. I think that the game was as interesting a display of defensive game planning as you have ever seen, and a real masterpiece in a lot of ways. I also think that it was pretty boring to watch for most people.
They say this on Twitter, and I think it's true. First of all, this game was much more for the football hardcores than for the average fan. And second of all, this game was more interesting to watch in a replay when you know what the strategies are and you can watch them develop than it was live, trying to figure out what the strategies were and just getting frustrated by the constant three and outs. I mean, one thing I will say about defensive football is that in general, negative plays and turnovers are more exciting to watch than three and outs. From a hardcore football perspective, especially watching on a replay when you can watch the strategies develop, that may not be true. But watching live and for the average fan, it's not that defensive football is boring. It's that three and outs are boring. Unlike a lot of the great defensive performances in Super Bowl history, this game did not include a lot of turnovers and only
a big pick six that helped decide the game. Nothing like that.
Right.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm with you all the way. It was mostly a punt fest. And you know what? I think we can be hardcore football people and also say that as far as a live Super Bowl went, it was not the most exciting. A lot of the times, depending on who you were pulling for, a lot of the time, I think you were probably pretty frustrated with how they were playing.
It did have the advantage of being tense, right? I mean, I think it was Tanier who was saying on Twitter, but he's certainly not the only one, that he'll take this over 43-8 any day of the week.
Oh, blowout for sure.
There was a lot of excitement in the beginning of 43-8 when you realized just how much Seattle was going to clobber Denver, and it was like, wow, this is incredible. That had all the excitement, whereas this was just very slow developing. You just kept being like, all right, come on, someone's got to have some offense. Okay, come on, someone's got to have some offense.
Ooh, a record punt.
The Rams, somebody's got to have some offense. Like, it's going to have to happen at some point. There's got to be some offense, right? So that was frustrating. But I do think going back and watching, knowing in retrospect the strategy.
A very good All-22 Super Bowl.
Yes, this is the All-22 Super Bowl. Much more interesting from that perspective. I will say, I've heard a lot of people talking about this as the best defensive performance in Super Bowl history, and that's a ridiculous statement. And it shows the sort of recency bias that we always get when we talk about Super Bowls. It's far from the greatest defensive performance.
Is it Ravens against the Giants? Is that up there?
By DVOA, the best defensive performance was the Ravens against the Giants, which is at like minus 120. This one's at minus 56. They have to remember the Rams had 4.3 yards of play with only one turnover. The 2000 Giants were kept to 2.6 yards of play and turned the ball over five times. I mean, you look at the drive chart for this game, and it's like punt, 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 punt. Well, the drive chart for that game is like punt, punt, interception, punt, interception, punt, interception. Like, it's worse. So as great as the defensive – and you can say that scheme-wise, given the quality of the Patriots' defense during the regular season, this may have been the best scheming of defense in a Super Bowl. One, I mean, the Ravens' defense had more talent. That Ravens' defense had a better performance. And two, there's also a pretty good, well-schemed defensive Super Bowl by Bill Belichick against the Bills, and a pretty well-schemed defensive Super Bowl by Bill Belichick against the Rams the first time.
2001, yep.
Right.
Yeah, I mean,
those
absolutely.
Those are also among the best Super Bowl defensive great game plans of all time. So.
Also, so I think 2 years before, I think it was 2 years before that, when the Rams won the Super Bowl over the Titans, that was the first exciting Super Bowl I can ever really remember from my childhood. Before that, I remember most Super Bowls usually being terrible. The NFC would kill the AFC. So we've really gotten spoiled if we're complaining about a close game like we got this week here.
Absolutely. And I will say also, I mean, this isn't even necessarily the best defensive performance of just the last couple of years. One thing I went and I did a list of the top defensive DVOA in Super Bowl, and slightly ahead of the Patriots in this game. And remember, this includes adjustments for opponent, but slightly ahead of the Patriots in this game were both Carolina and Denver in the same game 3 years ago. That game was truly a defensive festival. The Broncos had 3.5 yards of play and went 1-for-14 on third downs and won the game.
Yeah, that's something else. Pat Rowley, he pulled an interesting stat on Tom Brady. He joined the kind of been carried to a Super Bowl victory club. He, Peyton Manning, I think in that game you're talking about, and John Elway all earned rings with no touchdowns and one interception in the Super Bowl. And each of those guys was also at least 37 at the time. Now, the only other QBs to do that in the last 45 years, zero touchdowns and at least one interception, Troy Aikman in 1994, when they didn't really need him to do much to dominate the Bills, and then Big Ben in his age 23 2006 season, he won a Super Bowl going 9-for-21 for 123 yards, zero touchdowns, and two interceptions.
Right, 2005 season, 2006.
Yes, 2006 Super Bowl. Good correction there.
So that's one of the things that's always hard to talk about the year of the Super Bowl. It's one of the reasons they use the Roman numerals is because, like, was this the 2018 Super Bowl or was this the 2019 Super Bowl?
Because these it was LIII.
It was LIII. So, yeah, the Patriots' fabulous defensive scheme essentially had two linebackers up on the line of scrimmage all the time. It was a lot of sort of almost a 6-1 and sometimes a 6-0. Defects,
right?
And Hightower essentially playing as defensive linemen.
So what they're doing here is they're taking what the Rams like to do. They like to run this zone scheme. That, you know, their whole offense is predicated on outside zone, being able to run this play. And what they did was they dictated how the Rams were going to have to block that by putting six men on the line of scrimmage, by occupying each of those offensive linemen with somebody directly over them. You're not allowing anybody to release to the second level. You're not letting Aaron Cromer get that offensive line into all of the clever things that they'd really like to do in their well-polished zone blocking system. So it was a really genius wrinkle there, and it was a very slow response by the Rams. We saw Dante Hightower freed up to run all over the field and make plays, and then he was dropping down and pass rushing on third down too. That was one of the big keys, I definitely thought. Paired with that on the back end, we saw the Patriots come out and play more zone than man. We didn't have it at 90% zone like we were hearing some of the people say. We had 24 zone snaps to 19 man snaps, but still way different than what we would see from the Patriots in the regular season, and a very different result. The Patriots were good at man during the regular season. 51% completions allowed, 6 yards per attempt. They stunk at zone. 75% completions, second worst in the league. 8.9 yards per attempt, second worst in the league. They went to it here, and it seemed to really, really confuse Jared Goff, and the Rams just didn't have an answer for it.
It's a lot of quarters, and you do wonder whether teams next year that play the Rams are going to sort of try to copy what the Patriots did in the Super Bowl, playing quarters, playing their linebackers close to the line of scrimmage on the outside to take away outside zone. And the other amazing thing the Patriots did, they sent in two defensive plays. And this is an example of the kind of thing where you don't know this during the game. We found this out afterwards and why this game is more interesting to watch on replay. They sent in two defensive calls on every play. And when 15 seconds were on the game clock and Sean McVay was shut off from talking to Goff, they would switch their look so that McVay could not talk to Goff about what he was seeing on the field. And you wonder, first of all, will teams start to do that against the Rams next season? And second of all, why didn't the Rams do the best thing to counter that, which would have been to go to a hurry-up offense where Goff snapped the ball before there were 15 seconds left on the play clock?
And that's why Belichick won this game. Belichick, you know, that was checkmate right there. It's such an indictment on Jared Goff. He's like a college quarterback looking at the sideline for the play call to come in. It's a real indictment on him and where he's at in his quarterbacking career. And I know people say, oh, he was amazing this year. He did a lot of things great. I'm not questioning his ability to throw the football. I think he's a very good player. He did a lot of really great things this year. That would scare me. That aspect, he took
the decision-making skills. Yeah, we're going to have some discussions in the next few months about Goff's future. It's already sort of started the discussion of, if you're the Rams, do you try to trade Goff before you have to sign him to an extension? Because once you sign him to an extension, that's a huge amount on your salary cap. What if he's not the guy? I think Goff may have now taken over from Kirk Cousins as the official player where scouting and stats have the biggest disagreement. Because Goff's stats, I mean, not in this game, but Goff's stats for the season will still be very good. But we clearly saw what his deficiencies were in this game.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it. Being able to split out Goff from McVay is going to be the challenge, I think, of a lot of analysts going forward as we start to really get to evaluate these guys. And it's going to be difficult because they're so connected in so many different levels. So one thing you mentioned that was frustrating, we didn't see the Rams really try the hurry up. Somebody suggested on Twitter at some time this year that we should just convince all offensive coordinators that they're down by 14 points at the beginning of the game, just so that they'll actually call plays in a way that it's productive towards scoring points. I wonder if the Rams had taken that attitude towards this game, maybe they would have turned the ball over. I don't know, but it seems hard to believe to me that they would put CJ Anderson on the field if they were trying to score points versus Todd Gurley. Very frustrating there. And also frustrating, we saw them go to 12 personnel a little bit. So let's look at these 11 and 12 personnel breakdowns. Warren Sharp did a pretty nice job with this, with some of the SIS data. But I just want to get this clear for everybody out there. The Patriots were very good against the Rams' preferred 11 personnel this year. 59% completions allowed, 6.5 yards per attempt. Whereas against 12, they struggled. 8.8 yards per attempt, a 97 quarterback rating against. Now, the Rams only had 16 pass attempts in 12 personnel in the entire regular season. That was the fewest in the NFL, half as many as the second fewest team, who happened to be the Patriots. But on those 16 plays, they were good. 9.5 yards per attempt, 3 touchdowns, no interceptions. We saw what they were going into this game. They ran 14 times. They ran 12 personnel in the Super Bowl versus 49 plays and 11 personnel during the Super Bowl. So they did make an adjustment a little bit. They tried it in the second half when it was clear that they weren't getting anywhere in their usual 11 personnel package, but then they didn't go back to it enough. They would have success and then they would come back to kind of their usual stuff that wasn't working. And it seemed to me, with the Patriots doing what we were talking about before, putting all these guys on the line of scrimmage, having all those bodies up there, creating that numbers advantage versus the 11 personnel, bringing that second tight end into the game, creating an extra gap that the defense has to account for in the run game, is something that I think they needed and I think was offsetting the strategy. And it was very frustrating to see them not use it.
The advantage of trying to throw to tight ends, especially once there was no Patrick Chung on the field, I believe there was one target to a tight end all game, which was not caught.
Right.
It's not like Everett's a bad player. Everett's a guy who can make some plays.
Right. They were unable to take advantage, though, of that injury by Chung. And they probably could have done a little bit more to manipulate what should have been, you know, a sort of position that the Rams offense is built to attack a lot of the year. I was disappointed there. I was disappointed with Todd Gurley. What do you think is going on there?
I actually talked to someone from the Rams before the game, and they said Gurley was totally healthy. So I do not understand the lack of playing Gurley. But here's the thing. Gurley actually had a good number of snaps. He just didn't have a lot of
snaps. I wouldn't call it a good number. It wasn't half the snaps.
Well, he had a lot more snaps than he had plays. There were a lot of snaps he was on the field, but he didn't carry the ball. And this was surprising. He didn't go out on routes very much.
Right. It seems like something's going on there. This is Malcolm Butler all over again for me. I still think he's got to be injured. I'm still waiting to hear about what surgery he's going to have to fix himself up. I even think when he's talked sometimes, he's kind of let it slip that it's not totally healthy.
Gurley played 66% of the offensive snaps. That's not – you don't play 66% of the snaps if you're heavily injured.
Right. And he looked good. He ran, what, 19 miles an hour, they were saying, at a certain point?
Yeah, he had a play that was called back by holding, but he was fast on that play and gave a lot of yardage. And
so what is it? Is it a personal thing? I mean, what do we even think of Malcolm Butler at this point? Do we even know the answer to that one?
I mean, I think Malcolm Butler had a bad year in Tennessee, I think. Gurley – I mean, some of it may have been scheming, that McVay just got outthought by Belichick and he just didn't want to run the ball very much. But again, I don't understand Gurley not going out on pass routes. The Patriots were not a good team against running backs in the passing game this year. That's my confusion, is why they didn't use Gurley as a receiver more. That's also what really separates him from CJ Anderson.
Yeah. So I'm still scratching my head over that one. On the other side of the ball, the Patriots offensive line, argument could have been made for them to be the MVPs of this one. That four-minute offense, I mean, full disclosure, I was rooting against the Patriots. And that four-minute, it was just absolutely brutal to watch. When they're going to run and they just run it down your throat like that, there's nothing you can do about it. And it's not even like, Burkhead is making people miss or breaking tackles. It's just a matter of domination up front.
And also, I saw somewhere, I think it was the Next Gen Stats, their recording of pressure, but I'm guessing that the SAS recording would be similar, that this was like the lowest pressure rate that Brady faced all year, which is remarkable.
Yeah, they've just been outstanding throughout the playoffs. We chart a lot of 3 and 5 steps there. We don't chart them taking a lot of 7-step drops, which is a part of that. You know, part of it is the play calling. It's that Brady doesn't take sacks and get himself in situations like that. But, man, they played great.
And there were plays where you literally could see they were triple-teaming Aaron Donald. Like, they knew where the problem was, and they were going to stop him from doing this.
No doubt about it. Okay, I think we've hit most of the points that we wanted to talk about. One more before we get out of here. Will Gronk retire?
All the talk in the Patriots media expects that he will. That said, first of all, as a blocker this season, he was still fantastic. But you don't pay a tight end that kind of money to be a blocker. As a receiver, he certainly came out in this game and looked like the Gronk of old. I mean, he was, he made the huge play that essentially won the game. I mean, it didn't score the touchdown, but the 2-yard rushing touchdown afterwards was not as, he got them down to the goal line. So I think he's still got it in him. There is, a little bit of a question of if they feel he's declined a little bit, will they be merciless and cut him? And then does he want to continue to play? He said he doesn't want to play for a quarterback other than Tom Brady. So does he see the writing on the wall that the Patriots tend to get rid of a player a year too early rather than a year too late? Does he see that writing on the wall, know he's hurting, and say, I don't even want to go through all that. Let's just.
Well, it's possible. Last year he overruled the trade, right? He used his veto there.
That's right. He was going to be traded to the Detroit Lions.
So it seems like the Patriots have definitely considered life after Gronk. And I think for a few years, they've been kind of trying to limit his exposure in certain ways in terms of, especially defensive backs getting hits on his legs. I think this year we really saw him become much more of a blocker because it's those situations where he's much more susceptible to that injury risk. And kind of, he made that play that helped win them the game, like you just said. And that's who Gronk has been for them. Go back to when they were playing, who was that? The Chargers, when they split out Gronk 1-3 and he was able to win the game for them. He's still maybe the most pivotal player, obviously outside of Brady, on that offense. You could make the argument him or Edelman. Obviously Edelman had a lot more action in this one, but Gronk, when it really came down to make a play that actually helped get points on the board, I think that this could... It's interesting the way that they've been able to kind of shield him, and I wonder if it'll go on like that. Patrick pulled a nice split here where over the last 2 seasons, in games decided by 10 points or fewer, Gronk has 87 yards per game. Games decided by more than 10 points, he has 55 yards per game. It's clear that they're trying not to use him when they don't have to, and we saw that more than ever throughout these playoffs. It might be at the point now, though, where – man, you see him run out there, and he just doesn't look like we're used to seeing professional athletes look like when they run.
Right. It's do you pay $9 million or whatever for a guy who's you're only going to use in close games at the end of the season? Do you feel like he fits under the cap that way? That's the question.
All right. we will get out of here after a nice quick one. Anything else that you wanted to talk about before we go?
Are you excited for the Alliance of American Football?
I'm getting pretty excited. I haven't done a lot of research trying to figure – I haven't, like, figured out my favorite team or anything yet. But I'm excited for there to be some football. Sit back, check it out. I think it's going to be kind of interesting.
I think the most interesting story will be players who come out of this league and get themselves NFL careers out of it, and there will be some.
He hates
the fact is that there are players – right, there are players – who are not in the league right now, who just need to showcase their talents to get a spot, and then guys will get injured and they'll get a chance. But we won't know who those players are for another few months. So that's sort of interesting. The other interesting thing will be to see what happens with the Schiano rule, the fact that they are eliminating kickoffs and that they're going to have the fourth and 12 from the 28 if you want an onside kick. But you can't surprise – it's not going to be a punt. There's just going to be no kickoff. And then if you want an onside kick, you have to be losing by 17 or more or in the last 5 minutes of the game. And then you have to convert fourth and 12 from the 28 in order to, quote unquote, onside kick. And watching how that works will be very interesting.
Yeah, I'm interested to see something different, even if I don't care the guy who you just named it for. I hadn't heard
that. Well, congratulations, because the guy who I just named it for is probably the next defensive coordinator of the Patriots, isn't he?
Yes, very possible. Is that the news coming out right now?
Yeah, that is the news coming out, that he is the next defensive coordinator. So it's interesting that he, that's the first time that they're taking someone from outside the organization rather than promoting from within. But, you know, he's close to Belichick, so he is the replacement for Flores as Flores goes off to Miami.
We will be fascinated to see how that plays out, and especially with Miami, with not just Flores, but a Patriots offensive coordinator.
Chad O'Shea was the heir apparent to Josh McDaniels, will now go off and be Miami's offensive coordinator instead.
Lucky guy getting to work with whatever quarterback he's going to work with.
It's not going to be Ryan Tannehill.
Nope, sounds like he's cut. All right, so we are going to sign off. As we mentioned earlier, we are going to keep it going during the offseason. You'll get a mix of the usual Matt and Aaron combination, but we'll also have some different guests on from time to time and different topics. You can keep up with us on Twitter at Matt Mano, at
F-O-H-S. F-O_A-S-C-H-A-T-Z. And by the way, if you like the podcast, we don't say this as often as other podcasts do, but hey, you should rate us because it'll help people find us and listen to us. So rate us in your favorite podcast app and tell people that you like the podcast.
Yes, check us out, and also check out the SIS Football Rookie Handbook. It's available at activesports.com. It's available on Amazon, and it will be shipping on February 15th. So look out for that. All right, have a great week, everybody, and we'll talk to you next week.